When Jesus came into the earth, he did not use a perfect system. I'd like you to know that only within the context of Jesus being the head of the church is the church of Christ perfected. Now, you and I are still growing in perfection, and we will continue to grow in perfection until we see him in glory. The body of Christ is only going to be perfect at the time when the rapture happens and there is a transformation of our lowly bodies into glorified bodies. My name is KJ Ajayi. I'm privileged to be the senior pastor of the Incorruptible City Church and the president of Discipleship Trust. I'd like you to know that there are certain deep ends as it relates to the body of Christ that is not a day-to-day reality or knowledge that is placed in front of the saints. When you look at the human body, you would realize that you see people wearing clothes and gowns walking on the streets, but there are 37 billion cells walking in those people functioning at diverse levels, at diverse depths, towards different ends. Do you know that the human heart pumps 4.7 liters of blood and carries it across 60,000 miles of blood vessel every minute? Now again, don't forget that the Bible tells us that that which is spiritual can be learned from that which is natural. In the life of the church, especially those who are called into ministry offices, the apostle, the prophet, the evangelist, the pastors and teachers have tremendous responsibilities. Those who have genuinely embraced the call of God and are laboring ceaselessly. Many times, it is very easy to hurl stones or to hurl attacks against these men. Why? They are human. And many of them also make mistakes. As a matter of fact, I'll tell you, I don't think there's any man of God anywhere that does not have his own short ends. All right? But when you look carefully, there are mistakes that come as a result of poor discipleship. It does not in any way reduce the quality of the work that that man has done or the value of his labors in the secret place for the saints that he has labored over. There are mistakes in the area of the explanation of doctrine that are genuinely and sincerely made by certain men who have attained to certain stature that of a truth. The consequence of those mistakes can be far-reaching, however, because of the way they've been groomed, they will need certain people of understanding and matured concept of the Word of God to go behind the scene and call them aside and say, "Sir, you did this explanation this way. This is not what the Bible teaches." Now, if such a man of stature is humble enough, he may be able to accept responsibility for that doctrine and go back and correct it. However, if he does not accept that what he has taught is inaccurate, then he has a lot to give account to God for. When Jesus came into the earth, he did not pull down the synagogue to build the millennial temple. Jesus simply entered into the synagogue and took the scrolls of his day and read from it the truth. Jesus, of course, knew that he was doing away with Judaism, but Jesus did not carry out a guerrilla revolutionary activism in his day. Although he entered into the temple and he flogged men out of the temple, even the man selling the dove and merchandising the dove. But you realize that within that system of error, Jesus recognized what the dove represents and simply told the man, "Carry this dove away from here." That dove does not mean that's the Holy Spirit. That dove is simply a bird. But because of what that dove represented to Jesus, Jesus, in sending others away, turning over tables of money changers, he restrained himself when he got to where the dove is because of what the dove means. In our walk with God, one of the things most people have not understood is that at times you refrain from dealing ruthlessly with a thing, not because of what that thing is in itself, but because of what that thing represents. And so in most instances, we have seen certain individuals just get up and fling men who have labored decades in the vineyard, through whose ministry and life men have been able, many untold millions have gone to eternity with Jesus standing in the light. And because of a couple of mistakes here and there, have come into the public and dragged them in the mud, uncovered them in the open, and they think that they are doing Christ a service. No, you're doing Jesus and the body of Christ a disservice. And in some other instances, we have seen where men are unable to discern what the mind of God is and think that what is topmost and what is most important is just pointing out an error. listen, you will understand that apostasy has been here before Jesus came. Apostasy was here while Christ was here. And Paul said, we are not like many that peddle the word of God. But Paul did not make it his assignment to begin to look for those peddling the word of God and make the exposure of those men peddling the word of God his ministry. There was no way Paul could do that kind of ministry and still be able to fulfill his ministry. Paul traveled to countless nations, countless cities, seeking to witness, confronting thrones, upstaging principalities and powers, and bringing the gospel to bear on many cities. He broke the belly of the earth in many cities so that the water of the gospel could penetrate those cities, and long after he had gone, the word of God was available to people. What if Paul took it upon himself to stay back in Jerusalem and begin to analyze the revelations that God had given to him, to the apostles that were before him, just to prove to them that he knew better than them and their positions on certain things as it related to the Gentiles was wrong, or they were not even up to date in their revelation of the truth concerning the Gentile, he would have forfeited his ministry. One of the things I want you to understand in this video is that the body is a very complex, delicate mass with many back-end operations that does not allow us to see many front-end operations. You could see a person, he's walking, he looks frail and tired. He's having headache. Now, that headache is a sign that something is wrong deep down, somewhere beyond what the eyes can see. And many instances, people have been judged wickedly for behaving in certain ways without people who are judging them even really realizing that this is either a bipolar disease or this is some kind of genetic disorder that is producing crazy mood swings in this person, and therefore we have dealt with them without measure, without compassion, because oftentimes than not, we take things at face value and never pray for ourselves to investigate before the Lord. Perhaps there is something we are not seeing. We just go out against ourselves and begin to fight, bring our cutlass, and gather a group of people who will chant our own cause and say, yeah, you are the one that is right. He's the one that is wrong. And then a crazy discussion ensues, and the spirit of slander takes on the one that thinks is right and begins to assault the one that thinks is wrong. Now, oftentimes than not, most people do not realize that when you as a child of God open your mouth in slander against another child of God, you give the enemy a tool to work with to assault that other child of God. In some instances, in his or her dream life, visions begin to pop up, not the one that the Lord is giving, but the ones that the enemy is machinating on the account of the words that you have spoken. And these visions can penetrate in the realm of the spirit into the space of this man, or into the space of this woman, or into the space of this servant of God, and crisis can begin to ensue because he himself may not even be in a proper position to discern accurately. The most painful aspect of this are the aspects that I'll bring up subsequently, and they relate to how the next generation reacts and how the body of Christ generally responds, and needless casualties that happen when good men take it upon themselves to discipline the body of Christ when Christ isn't doing anything about it just yet. Till I come your way in the next episode, the Lord bless you.